things that I was going to say, but that's all right. We tend to do that. He says things that I want to say, and I say things he wants to say, and I pick songs, and he picks songs, and yeah, it's great. It really is. So he told you that I have this in regards to that whole idea of women preaching, okay? And I thought that maybe if I spoke on women preaching, I thought, you know, that's kind of weird, you know, if I'm going to toot my own horns, like, maybe I'll get, you know, Kevin should preach that, right, instead of me. But it has been a long, long struggle for me as a woman. I have felt for years that I have these gifts or these abilities that are in there, but no opportunities or even permission as a woman to do them. And as we've been here at Grace Life, this is going into our third year, and as we're learning and growing in grace, and I've spoken briefly with Kevin about women preaching. I was like, well, what do you think? And I was like, you know, there were many times when, you know, he needed someone to preach, and I thought, oh man, you know, secretly I was hoping that he'd ask me. But I was like, how's he supposed to ask me? How's he supposed to know that, right? And so I believe Kevin had a message a few months ago now, I'm trying to remember. And what he was doing is he was trying to encourage us as a body to, in the gifts and talents that we all have, and discovering them. And he said, you know, he wanted to be that facilitator to help bring those gifts and talents up. And I thought, oh my goodness. I said, okay, well, maybe this is an opportunity for me to tell him how I'm feeling. And of course, Wes knows, you know, we've been talking about this, and he knows. And he says to me, he says, you know what, you should just tell him. And I'm like, you think? And I was like, oh yeah. You know, and I'm really freaking out, because I'm just like, you know, I still have this stigma, I'm woman, right? And how many women preachers do you know of? And you know, maybe you'll hear them at a retreat or, you know, in Sunday school, but not in this position. So this is an honor for me to be here. And here goes. So, but the other thing I wanted to say too is that when I asked Ken, I said, okay, Ken, so how long do you preach? Like, I actually never timed his messages. So I'm like, so how long is it? And like, how long should I time for? He's like, well, as long as you're less than 3 hours, you should be good. I was like, oh, 3 hours? And I said, okay, all right, I got it. You guys ready? No, just kidding. Just kidding. It's not 3 hours. So for many years, I also wanted Wes to be a preacher, because I wanted to be a preacher's wife. I thought, you know, that would be great. And so Wes has done a few of these, he's stepped in the pulpit here for Kevin a few times, and I didn't know that maybe that was actually supposed to be me and not him, and I've been trying to get him to do it, and he's just like, okay, I'll do that. And then, you know, he's like, well, I want to do that. And he's like, you know what, I don't know if I want to do that. I'm just like, maybe it's supposed to be me, you know? So anyways, here I am. As some of you already know, you've heard the story about how Wes and I came to the Grace and Word of Faith message, and how what that little journey looked like. What we believed back then, that's many years from now, what I believed back then, I look back and I go, man, I don't believe anything like that today. And I know that even if I look back from this day, a year from now, I'm like, wow, I had no idea that, you know, I was like, well, that wasn't quite right, and, you know, and revelation just comes as we allow the teaching to come. And the truth is, you know, sometimes we think, well, this person, they've got it all figured out. You know, truth is, no one ever will, no matter who you are, no matter how famous you are, no matter how great of a preacher you are, no how many thousands or upon thousands of people actually attend your church, none of us ever have arrived. But, you know, we add to our faith every day, new revelation, and we continually learn and see God on a whole new level. So as I thought about what I wanted to share with you today, well, there's a few things I wanted to talk about that I thought about. But if you follow our marriage page, you'd know that maybe that would not be a good idea to do that right here. That might be a better time for that. So we're going to do something different. So I've entitled my message, "What Do You Do When Your Faith Seems to Not Be Working?" We ask that question all the time. What's wrong with my faith? How many times have you gone through something and you look back and you feel like your faith took a beating? How many times have you believed God for something only to be disappointed because you didn't get what you thought you would? How often do you feel like your faith is weak? And if you could just pray a little more, read a little more scripture, or maybe fast even, you know, then maybe my faith would be where it's at to see more victory. These are all common things among believers, but especially in our circles, in the Word of Faith and the Grace circles. But my goal here is to walk you through some of the answers. Not all the answers, because I don't know everything there is about that, but I have gone through a few things in my life that I hope that I've learned. So let's first start off with what the definition of faith is. So faith is defined as complete trust or confidence in someone or something. It's a strong belief in God or in the doctrines of a religion based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. For atheists, this is what gets them there. It's like, I need proof, I need science, I need proof. But, you know, we believe in something, and we don't need the proof. Sometimes we wish we had proof. A system of another definition for faith is a system of religious beliefs. Now that's just, you know, not Christian, it's any religious belief. Or the fourth one is a strongly held belief or theory. Now that's not necessarily having to do with religion, but it's a strongly held belief in something or a theory. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 11:1 that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. If we wanted to make that verse a little more simpler to understand, we could say it like this. Faith, or having complete trust, which we look back at our definition, is the assurance of things expected, the confident expectation of things we do not yet see. So, we've got what faith is, we've defined faith, so let's look at some examples in the scriptures of people that have been credited with having great faith. So let's go to Matthew chapter 15, and we will be reading verses 21 through 28. Then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, Send her away, for she cries out after us. But he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And she said, Yes, Lord. Yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Now this Gentile woman had great faith. That's what it says. Jesus said she had great faith. She knew she didn't deserve anything. Jesus called her a dog. But she knew she didn't deserve anything. But she knew what Jesus could do and who Jesus was. She was fully convinced that if she could just get to him, she would get what she needed. So how did she know this? So my question is, well, how did you know that? You are a Gentile woman. How are you going to know? And so in today's day, you could, you know, ask, well, did she go to social media? Because Facebook knows everything, right? Or did she read the local newspaper? I don't know how many still read the newspaper, but I think we still have such a thing. Or did she ask Google? Everybody says, you know, ask Google. Google knows that too. Well, of course not. In those days, there was only one way she could have heard. That was testimony. She heard what people were saying, and she believed. Let's go to Luke chapter 7. Luke 7, verses 1 through 9. Luke 7, 1 through 9. Now, when he concluded all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. And a certain centurion servant who was dear to him was sick and ready to die. So when he heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving, for he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them, and when he was already not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Therefore, I did not even think myself worthy to come to you, but say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turned around and said to the crowd that followed him, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And those who were sent, returning to the house, found the servant well, who had been sick. The centurion was completely convinced that all Jesus had to do was say the word, and his servant would be healed. He didn't even need Jesus to come to his house. He was convinced that that's all he needed. Jesus called that great faith. You notice in verse 3 where it says the centurion heard. Heard is the key word there. Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So from these two stories here, it seems that there could be levels of faith. If Jesus has declared these two people that got great faith, the opposite must be true, little faith. So let's go look at some scriptures where Jesus has said about little faith. Matthew 6:30. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Matthew 14:31. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? And then Matthew 16:89. But Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, O you of little faith, why do you reason among yourselves because you have not brought no bread? Do you not yet understand or remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets you took up? Jesus here talks about little faith. All too often, we take those words and we take it at face value and we feel guilty. Well, they had great faith. How did they get great faith? I have little faith. I feel like I have little faith. What am I supposed to do? I want to have great faith. And we've been bombarded with this all over the place. So let's dig a little bit further. The Greek word for faith in the story of the Gentile woman and the centurion is pistis. And it means to be fully persuaded or to have full assurance. So if you take the words great faith, you can say it like this. Great faith is having great assurance or being fully convinced or persuaded. So now let's look at the words little faith, which at face value could make us think that our faith is weak or not as strong as it could be or not like the next person. Like sometimes we go, man, that person's got great faith. I wish I was more like them. So the word here for little faith is a little different. It's not the same. I don't know how to pronounce it, but oligopistos. And it means lacking confidence or to be incredulous. So you can say it like this. Little faith is having little confidence or lacking confidence. So now when you read about the stories about great faith and little faith, it paints just a little bit of a different picture. The centurion and the Gentile woman were fully convinced, there was no doubt in their mind, that Jesus would do what they heard he had done for others. Great faith. And you follow? Fully convinced, great faith. When Peter was walking on the water and started to sink, he lacked confidence that Jesus would hold him up, even through the storm, even after he was walking on the water. Imagine that. Little faith. He started to look at the wind and the waves all around him, and he took his answer off of Jesus, or took his eyes off of Jesus, and he started looking at the wind and the waves. What do you call that? Lacking confidence. Little faith. So, I offer to you that there is actually no such thing as levels of faith. Either you have faith, which in essence is great faith, or you lack confidence, which is little faith. And at any given time in your walk with God, you can have both, little faith or great faith, fully convinced or lacking confidence. Now, the real big question is, this is what we always ask all the time, how do I get faith? Let's first answer the question, what causes little faith? The answer is doubt, unbelief, and fear. When doubt and unbelief are allowed to occupy space in our minds, they will cause our fear to short circuit or become little. It doesn't mean you don't have any, it just short circuits it and just it becomes ineffective. Faith and doubt actually come the same way that faith does. I hear it. Misappropriated faith is fear. And fear, the root cause for doubt and unbelief, comes when you hear things that make you doubt what God has said. Satan's number one goal, to make believers doubt what God has really said and to doubt that he will actually do what he said he would do. Fear, if left alone, will wreak havoc in your life, causing you to miss out on all blessings of God. Fear will torment you, and we read that in scripture too. So my question to you, or many questions actually, what are you hearing? What are you reading? What are you watching? Are you hearing bad reports? Are you hearing how this person believed for healing and didn't get healed? Are you hearing about this one family that was left without a husband and a daddy after an accident? Are you hearing about this Christian marriage, another Christian marriage ending up in divorce? Are you hearing about how a madman entered the church, killing dozens of people? Are you hearing about how gas prices continue to rise and making it harder and harder for us to make ends meet? Are you allowing doubt and fear to keep your faith from working? Doubt and fear don't actually get rid of your faith. They just keep it from being effective. So the problem really isn't a lack of faith, but rather too much doubt and unbelief. Mark 9:24 says, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. So let's go back to that question, how do we get great faith? So before we go on, you need to know this. Faith isn't something you get. Faith is something you have. So if you don't remember anything else I said tonight, remember that. Faith is not something you get. Faith is something you have. So how can I say that? Romans 12, verse 3. It says, for I say through the grace given to me, this is Paul speaking, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. I don't really like the way the New King James says that, but we'll get to that a little bit later. Hebrews 12, verse 2. Says, looking unto Jesus, the author, or the better word here is, if you look at the meaning of author, originator and finisher of our faith. That means Jesus is the beginning and the end of our faith, not us. So first, let's go back to Romans 12, 3. You will notice that if you look in the New King James, the word himself is italicized. That means the interpreters added that for clarification. I think that was really kind of a mess up. I love how the Aramaic New Testament puts it. So it goes like this. I don't think I put it up there in the Aramaic. I say then, through the blessings that are given me for all of you, do not look for anything outside of what you are supposed to look for, except look inside yourselves. Every human being, according to the measure of faith, that which Allah doled out to them. So not a measure, like the New King James says, I like the measure. What does that mean? Well, we are not to look anywhere for our faith except where it comes from God. We're not to look to ourselves for our faith, but only from where it came from. God did not give Wes or Kevin or Elena more faith than he gave me. As in a measure of faith, he gave each of us the measure of faith. That's entirely different. We all have the same faith. Every single one of us. The measure of faith. As it says in Ephesians 4, verse 5, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So, God deposited his faith into each of us. We all have the same. So when we talk about how faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, we're actually saying that faith is not anything in and of ourselves at all. You and I could not create a single thing without faith. Our faith is useless. Because if our faith was anything, we wouldn't need Jesus. Right? So, when we were learning about grace and learning about faith, and you know, and Mark 11, 23 and 24 talks about how, you know, you can say to this mountain, believe in your heart that it will be cast into the sea and you will have what you say. So in the word of faith, it was like, say what you want, you can have what you say. Believe in your heart, do not doubt, and what you say will come to pass. That is all scripture, yes. But aside from knowing what the will of God is, that can really mess a person up. How do I know? It happened to me. So, I have three awesome kids. I get horribly sick when I'm pregnant. And I told Wes when I was pregnant with Austin, my third, I said, never again. Don't ever let me do this again. Well, wouldn't you know, you forget. I forgot. And so a few years later, not only, you know, now I'm thinking, okay, well, you know what, I'm just going to believe God for my healing, which, you know what, is vital. That's, I believe that to this day, that you know, I was on the right track there. Where I messed up was, I said, you know what, let's have a girl. Scripture says, you know what, you can have to say. All right, so God, I'm going to use my faith, and we're going to have a girl. And that's what we tried. And all through my pregnancy, I gave her a name. She had a name. Her bedroom was pink. It was with her sister. I had people in my worship team, they go, you know, because I would say it. I would say, because, you know, the more you say something, the more you believe, right? Man, did I struggle with doubt? And I'm like, man, I need to just build up my faith. I need to speak more. I just need to believe. And I remember even reading in my diaries, I was like, you know, God, I'm just doubting. Please help me. You know what? I need to believe. I don't know why I'm so weak. What's wrong with me? I have a doubt. I go to the store, and I'd be like, I need to buy a new sleeper. I need to buy something. I want to buy something new. And I'd pick up the pink one. I'd put it in my hands. And in my spirit, I was like, oh, I just can't. What's wrong with me? Why can't I just believe? I'm going to have a girl. But I just couldn't buy the pink thing. I actually didn't buy it because I couldn't. People on my worship team, they would say, well, how can you just say you're going to have a girl? What if you have a boy? I'm not having a boy. I'm having a girl. Because I can have what I say. And our pastor at the time told me later on, he says, you know, I had a dream. You had a girl. I said, yes, I can go on that. Now I got something to go on because now I can believe. I said, okay, all right. I'm having a girl. Her name is Hannah, by the way. I love the name Hannah. And, you know, I was pretty much sick throughout the whole thing. I still believed God for healing, though, and I truly believe that it would have been much worse. And so my kids are young, and Braden would have been 9, Austin would have been 5, Haley would have been 7. So they're young. And here I am. You know, we would pray at nighttime, and then I'd get them to put their hands on my stomach. We'd pray for Hannah. Wow. I look back and I go, oh, you're so stupid. But that's where I was. That's where my faith was at. That's what I thought it was all about. Just like, you know what? You can have what you say, right? So lo and behold, the day comes. Baby comes. Fast and furious he was. He's not a she. She's a he. The moment he was born, in my spirit, I was like, you have no faith. You doubted too much. And I suffered. Condemnation, left, right, and center. Took me months to get over that. Not that I didn't want a boy. That wasn't the problem. The problem was I believed for a girl I was supposed to have. See where this is going? You can't just pick something up and say, I'll believe God for that. With my own faith. My faith. So anyways, I learned a little bit about faith, and that's not how it works. But can you imagine if he would have been a she? And I would have been so pumped up with myself, so full of pride that I believe God for a girl. And this is how you do it. This is how you have great faith. This is how you believe. That's not how it works. I look back and I go, God, you knew what you were doing. Because had I had that happen like that, my faith would have been messed up for the rest of my life. But it was a, I hurt people along the way. Most, you know, my kids, my husband, and my parents are here too. They, yeah, I've never actually talked about that with them in detail like that, so maybe now we've all, maybe we will. But God is faithful. He did not condemn me, I was condemning myself. So let's carry on. Suppose that we, right here, take a survey with all of us that are sitting here. Who's got the best burgers in town? Okay, I know who I think has got the best burgers in town. But this survey would include your experience and your opinion, which is the best. We would then read out what everybody said and then conclude from this data who's got the best burgers. Now, you may or may not have already have a preconceived idea and an opinion. But suppose you didn't. Suppose you never had a burger. Suppose you were searching. The data produced here would influence your beliefs about who has the best burgers, and more than likely would influence your decision the next time you wanted to grab one. Your decision would have been influenced by what you heard. There's nothing spiritual about burgers or this survey. But the fact that you made a decision based on what you heard is. Back to Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We all agree that Jesus is the word, right? And the word became flesh and dwelt among us, according to John 1:1. So if that is the case, then we can also say if hearing comes by the word of God, and the word is Jesus, then hearing Jesus is how faith comes. And where it comes from. This is where I had it all messed up. I thought faith was my own. That's not right. The faith that we have in us is nothing of ourselves. It is Jesus' faith. This is what I needed to know. This is what would have really made things a whole lot better. I needed to know that the faith inside of me is not my own. It's Jesus' faith. That's good news. Do you know what I mean? Why? Because now you don't have to conjure up your own faith and go, how am I going to build myself up? I need to believe God for this. I know that the doctor says that this is what's happening, but I just gotta build myself up. You don't have to build yourself up. Jesus' faith inside of you. Cool, that's good news. For me, that's good news. No matter what you've been told, you cannot do anything to get more faith. You know, you'll hear people say that, you know, this is how you do it. And I had a girl, I could have told everybody, this is how you do it, right? No matter how many times you study or confess, not that studying and confessing aren't good, but that doesn't get you more faith. What you can do, however, is use the faith that you already have. You can increase your faith also by decreasing doubt and unbelief. You can increase your faith simply by believing what Jesus said, who he was, what he has promised to you through the finished works of the cross. That's what we're preaching on here in November. Pastor Kevin's on the It Is Finished. When Jesus said, I have not seen such great faith, he wasn't saying that this man had his own faith. He wasn't saying that recognizing something in and of that person. What he was saying is he saw that person so fully convinced in who he was. That to him was great faith. Great faith is simply believing that Jesus will do what he said he would do, that Jesus has already done what he said he has done, and that he will do it for you. Great faith. Ephesians 2:8 and 9 also agrees with this. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is where I missed it, and that faith, which is not of yourself, is a gift from God. Where does faith come from? It comes from God. Whose is it? It's God's. Why? So no one can boast. Had I had a girl, I could have boasted left, right, and center and told everybody, no boasting here, because I really messed it up. So now, the faith that we have been given is Jesus' faith. And now we have the privilege of using that faith to get what God has already done for us through Jesus. Now just think about that for a minute. We had nothing. Jesus gave us his faith so we could have everything. It's quite brilliant, really. Plus, we can't take any credit for anything. So that removes any and all self-effort from receiving from God. How many of you have heard other believers or preachers tell you the reason you didn't receive your miracle is because you didn't have enough faith? Yeah? I've heard that. But guess right. Guess what? They were right. You don't! That's just great! You don't! You don't have enough faith at all. But guess who does? Jesus. When you realize the faith that you have is not your faith at all, but the faith of Jesus inside of you, you will never, ever again have to worry about having enough faith, ever. Jesus has enough faith for the whole world and then some. His faith will get you healed. His faith will never fail. His faith doesn't doubt. His faith is all you need. The faith that you and I have been given is faith that moves mountains. It's faith that calms every storm. It's faith that causes us to win in every situation. It is His faith that moves us into victory. Okay, so now how do we access this faith? If it's God's faith, Jesus' faith, deposited inside of us, how do we get that? So we look back at Romans 10:17. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the question is begged to answer, hearing what? Well, what do you think the Gentile woman heard? In the story we just read in the beginning. What do you think she heard? How about the feeding of the 5,000? Maybe she was even there. How about the healing of the Sabbath? How about healing of the mute and demon-possessed man? Or how about the resurrection of Jairus' daughter? Or the woman with the issue of blood? Or how about the paralyzed man? Or what about when he calmed the wind and the waves on the sea? This woman heard nothing but how Jesus went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed. That was how her faith grew. She didn't have social media or Google or TV. She only heard what others were saying. Word about Jesus back then spread so much that thousands upon thousands would come and hear him preach. There was no advertising. There was no nothing. It was just the word of the people. The news of Jesus was such good news. It drew everybody from everywhere. Today, it's not hard to find any kind of news you want to. If you're in the mood for bad news, you can find that. Our news outlets seem to thrive and gravitate towards bad news, because bad news sells. Bad news is the avenue for which the enemy infiltrates our minds with fear and doubt. Bad news is everywhere. A good news, on the other hand, it's not so easy to find. But it's out there. You gotta look for it. It's there. And we as believers, you and I, and in our church, can flood our neighborhoods with good news. We can fill up our Facebook feeds with nothing but good news. It makes some people so mad. How can you say that God of yours is so good? I know, because my God is good, and if you want to know, I'll tell you. This is why it's so vital to tell your story. Pastor Kevin spoke about that a few weeks ago with the I Declare I'm a Harvester. Studies have shown that unbelievers do not, more than likely, do not come to know Jesus inside our church building and inside our church halls. Where do they get to know Jesus? Out there, where the stories are being told, where people are seeing, you know, I want that. It's not because you drilled scripture into them. It's because they heard your story. Our testimony of God's goodness needs to be shouted from the rooftops. People need to hear how God rescued you from your addiction. People need to hear how your marriage was saved from divorce. People need to hear how Jesus kept your family safe during a storm. People need to hear of cancer being healed. People need to hear about miraculous provision. People need to hear how God helped you and you had no idea what to do. People need to hear. How many of you remember the song? Well, some of you might not, but some of you will. The song by Bon Jovi, "You Gave Love a Bad Name." Don't you think it's time we give Jesus a good name? Jesus attracted thousands of people in his day, yet today you just mention the name of Jesus and you receive all kinds of colorful words and thrown at you, the Bible thumper or Jesus freak or this or that. You just mention Jesus' name. But Jesus is the answer to every life problem. Jesus is everything you need, and we need to tell everybody, no matter what kind of names we call it. God deposited Jesus' faith inside of you as a means of accessing all of Jesus. So now that we know where faith comes from, how to increase our faith, and how to stop doubt and fear from short-circuiting our faith, we no longer have to be afraid of not having enough faith. You know, if the doctor says to you, you've got cancer, no fear. I have Jesus' faith inside of me. You can confidently approach any situation that comes your way with the faith of Jesus operating inside of you. Just like when the disciples asked Jesus to increase their faith in Luke 17, verse 6, he told them that all they needed was a mustard-sized faith. Do you know how big a mustard-sized seed is? It's so little bit. It's little. He said that's all they needed was mustard-sized faith. And they would be able to say to the mulberry tree, be pulled up from the roots and be planted in the sea. It would obey them. He was saying that all they needed was mustard-sized faith. Of the faith that he had already given them. Jesus' faith inside him. Increase our faith. Well, all you need is a little mustard-sized faith of that faith that I've already given you. Do you know what that means? It means that the faith of Jesus in us is so much, much more than we will ever need. If mustard-sized faith moves mountains, how much more the faith the size of an apple seed? That's like, what, 50 times bigger than a mustard seed? Or an orange seed? It's mind-blowing. We actually have so much faith inside of us. Ephesians 1 verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has already, that's key, who has already blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Spiritual blessings are the parent to the natural blessings. Spiritual blessings include everything we need for life and godliness, according to 2 Peter 1 verse 3. As his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue. So my question to you is, where are the spiritual blessings? Where is everything that we need for life and godliness? Where are they? Well, according to Ephesians, they are in heavenly places in Christ. Where's Christ? Inside of you. So where are the spiritual blessings? Inside of you. Oh, that's good news. So all we ever need for this life is already where? Inside of you. How do we access these blessings? Faith. Whose faith? Jesus' faith. How much faith does Jesus have? Lots and lots and lots. More than enough for the entire world. If you go to Philemon verse 6, it says that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in us, in Christ Jesus. Jesus' faith inside of us is effective when we acknowledge where all good things reside, in us, in Christ. So now, when we feel like our faith is not working, which, when I was pregnant, I really felt like it was not working. I struggled. But had I known that it was not my faith, it was Jesus' faith, I would have figured things out. I was like, wait a minute, this isn't right. The faith that you have has been given by God through Jesus to you in abundance. That faith was given so you could access all the spiritual blessings that were given to you from the beginning. It's time we recognize that everything we need is in us. It's time we access the faith of Jesus in us to receive all that God has done for us. It is time we acknowledge that every good thing is in us for our victory. Can you see that your faith is not the issue? Can you see that Jesus' faith is the only faith you need? Can you see that Jesus' faith is more than enough? Can you see that it is important to know what you are hearing and what you believe? Can you see that all you ever need is inside of you, because that is where Jesus is? Can you see the victory is yours? So, to answer our original question, what do you do when your faith doesn't seem to be working? It is clear that if we continue to focus on us and how we can do this, or how to get more faith, remember, you don't get more faith, you have faith, but you will continue to fail and miss the mark. However, once you realize that faith is nothing in and of ourselves, but everything to do with Jesus and his faith, guess what? We will win every single time. Amen. Repeat after me. I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.